I'm KFOR Sports Director Brian Brinkley. We've opened up our archives here at Channel 4 and remastered some of our Big 8 Conference football preview shows featuring some of the best names and best teams in college football. If you're a fan of college football in the 1980s, you'll enjoy this flashback in time. You're watching KFOR's College Football Flashback.
We've all heard about Nebraska's problems with 60 players being suspended for one game because of alleged infractions of using tickets and passes illegally. However, all of the Nebraska players will be available for the game on national TV tomorrow night against Florida State because of a stay of that penalty by the NCAA till a hearing next Tuesday. Colorado hasn't had any problems off the field lately, but on the field, their problem is to maintain the tremendous improvement they had last year, going from one of the worst teams to the most improved team in the country. Here's Bob Jr.'s report on Nebraska and Colorado.
More than anything, this one play in Colorado's game last year against Oregon showed everybody across the league the spirit was back in Boulder. The Buffs were headed for their first bowl bid in 8 seasons, and Bill McCartney was on his way to picking up Conference Coach of the Year honors. Quite naturally, Colorado's success has sparked fan interest like it was in the glory days of the 70s.
Realistically, I think people have plays that were competitive again. And I think that the season ticket sales and other things are up just because they know that we're going to be in the game. Anytime you have a good defense and a sound kicking game, you have a chance to beat anybody.
This is the most mature defense McCartney has ever had, with splendid players at linebacker and in the secondary. But the Buffs' real defense against enemy field position is punter Barry Hilton, who was named first team All-America as a freshman last year.
I came up here as a quarterback and played 2 years at quarterback, and then our punter graduated and we went to the wishbone, and I decided I didn't want to get killed, so I went to punt because we didn't have one and just practiced it all that summer, and then last year was the first year I really punted.
Buff coaches hope the development of smooth Mark Hatcher as a wishbone quarterback will keep Hilton on the sidelines most of the time. Colorado hosts OU and Nebraska, with their Buff bone expected to be terrific if Hatcher can improve in one crucial area.
Colorado climbed a lot of mountains last year, but one of the peaks reached was certainly not in the passing game, where the Buffs ranked dead last in the entire nation throwing the football. And Nebraska has similar concerns this year, but if the powerful Huskers pick up in their aerial assault, look out.
Unfortunately, Nebraska may have to improve their passing game more than they wanted to, because this simple-looking sweep at a scrimmage the day after we visited Lincoln severely damaged the knee of all-conference I-back Doug DeBose, and his career is over with the Huskers. That puts even more heat on Nebraska's new quarterback, Steve Taylor, who won a heated battle for the starting job over last year's regular McCathorn Clayton.
It's a big jump between freshman and ball. Now, I'm glad to be the number one quarterback. I hope I stay here for a while. But you never know, Mac is good, and you never know who can sneak up behind you.
Taylor has most of the Turner Gill-type moves on the ground, and he has shown a decent arm in practice, something Husker coaches are counting on to improve.
But what we're really going for is efficiency. You know, if we throw it 10 times a game and we complete 8, then we've done pretty well. And that's what we're after, rather than to try to throw it 25 or 30 times.
Defense will really be Nebraska's strength, because nose tackle Danny Noonan has been called the Big 8's next Tony Casillas. Mark Munford is back at linebacker, and the secondary is looked upon as the best Nebraska group of the 80s.
Last year, when Oklahoma State won the toss of the coin to start a game, Coach Pat Jones wanted to play some defense. That may change this year, because Oklahoma State could have one of the best offensive teams in the Big 8 Conference. Here's Robbie Robertson's preview of the 1986 Oklahoma State Cowboys.
Every opponent Oklahoma State plays in 1986 will be looking to stop All-America running back Thurman Thomas. He was the fourth leading rusher in the nation a year ago, gaining more than 1,700 yards. In the past, the Cowboy offense has consisted of Thomas running left, then Thomas running right, then throwing a pass. It won't be that way this year. OSU is blessed with more skilled people than ever before, and the plan is for a more wide-open offense than ever before.
I will be surprised if we're not pretty good offensively. We've never had as many of this type of athlete before. We've had them on defense, but we haven't had them offensively. In bits and pieces we have, but not as much as we do now. Which should indicate we'll be a very, very exciting football team.
In order for the Cowboy offense to be successful, quarterback Ronnie Williams will have to come into his own. Williams is a junior now, and he still has that pro-type arm. But because of injuries, Williams has never been able to play a full season. Williams will have to prove this is his year. And if it is his year, the Cowboys will be a good offensive football team.
Still making mistakes that I shouldn't make out on the field. And, you know, I worked on that this spring and tried to correct that. I went back to look at films and studied what I did wrong. And, And it showed up during the spring ball because I felt more comfortable about myself and I was dropping back freely and I felt pretty good.
Go! Sit hit!
It may take a while for the offensive line to gel. Only one starter returns. But there is talent up front, and by the time the conference season starts, OSU should be 4-0, and the entire offense should be in high gear.
There are some questions in Stillwater this year, and they center primarily around the defense. Third-year head coach Pat Jones has got to find replacements for guys like Leslie O'Neill, John Washington, James Hamm, and Ricky Adams.
The Cowboys won't be able to dominate defensively this year like they did last year. But the loss of last year's defensive stars may be a motivating factor this year.
We lost an awful lot of good football players last year, and yet we've got some awful good young kids coming back. The only real problem is a lot of them going to have to play before their time. But, you know, I think overall it's going to be a group that over the next few years, and including this year, that they'll get better. They'll be an exciting group to watch. And, you know, in time they'll be all good football players.
The strength of the Cowboy defense is the secondary. Mark Moore leads a group of defensive backs that should be among the best in the nation. Coach Jones says the Cowboys expect to win this year and expect to go to a bowl game. There is enough talent in Stillwater for all of that to happen.
When we come back, can the Sooners do it again? We'll take a look at Oklahoma for 1986. The Oklahoma Sooners are in much the same situation as Oklahoma State. From the standpoint, there are some question marks on defense, but their offense is loaded with talent. The one big difference is the fact that most preseason pollsters rank OU number one in the nation. Here's Robbie's look at the Oklahoma Sooners.
The Oklahoma Sooners had the best overall defense in the nation last year. Because of the loss of players like Tony Casillas, Kevin Murphy, and Jeff Tupper, OU will probably not be that good this year. But there are eight starters back on this year's defensive unit, and they know what it takes to win.
In the 24 ball games they've played in, they've never played a bad ball game. I mean, we might not have played up to some people's expectations or even our own, but we went out and played hard, and I think, again, that's a tribute to them. If we can do that, we're going to be, again, a good football team.
Brian Bosworth is the leader on the defensive team. As a sophomore, he was named the best linebacker in America. He truly becomes an angry person on Saturday. Even though OU has some holes to fill on defense, don't forget there's a little pride involved here. The Sooners are in the position of defending a national championship.
It gives us a chance to meet every challenge, and every challenge is going to be new each Saturday. Everybody's going to be looking to knock us off. I think that's going to keep us on the ball. With the teams we have to play the first six games, I think that everybody's going to be mentally able to go out each Saturday, barring any injuries, and give it 110%.
Oklahoma was able to win the national championship last year because they dominated games with defense. This year, watch the offense. They have a chance to be explosive.
Sophomore Jamel Holloway is 8-0 as the starting quarterback for the Sooners. He is just one of the ingredients that has OU fans excited about this year's offense. Oklahoma was third in the nation in rushing last year. And with the exception of Eric Pope on the offensive line, everybody is back this year. Holloway understates the fact the Sooners will be good again this year.
Offensively, I think we're going to be really, really good because everyone's already played 1 year together, and we did fairly well last year, and I really think that we didn't even put all the whole puzzle together last year. I think we still have a few more steps to go, and hopefully this year the whole puzzle will be put together.
No team has ever won back-to-back national championships three different times. OU has a chance to do that this year. All the ingredients are there to pull it off.
We look forward to the challenge. We like the role of being a favorite. Players come to Oklahoma because they want to be a part of something like this, and that's what we sell. Oklahoma has that mystique, that challenge, that tradition and heritage.
Defense will be the key for the Sooners in 1986. If they find they can stop people, the OU offense should be potent enough to put the Sooners back in the Orange Bowl with an opportunity to perhaps win another national championship.
As we've already mentioned, this is the 80th season for Big 8 football. But back in 1907, it wasn't known as the Big Eight Conference. Back then, it was the Missouri Valley Athletic Association. From that came the Big Six, then the Big Seven, and finally, the Big Eight.
Robbie, no matter what the name, the conference has been always noted for football tradition. There have been many great moments in football and other sports. Much too much to report in one story or one show, but Robert Allen, Channel 4 sports reporter, does have a brief look at Big Eight football tradition.
The year is 1971. Colorado, behind quarterback Ken Johnson, finishes third in the nation. Then on a late November afternoon at Owen Field in Norman, Nebraska, behind the determined running of I-back Jeff Kinney, beats Oklahoma 35-31 to win the national championship. Nebraska, Oklahoma, and Colorado, 1-2-3 in the nation. The greatest year for Big Eight football, and perhaps the greatest year ever for a single conference. That's what Big Eight tradition is all about. All Americans playing on great teams like that Husker squad back in 1971.
It's obvious from all the trophies and displays here in the entryway at Memorial Stadium that Nebraska does have a lot of football tradition, but Oklahomans say they have more. And to prove it, they say all you have to do is count the national championships.
Bud Wilkinson won three, coaching the Sooners back in the 50s. His 56 team shut out 6 of 10 opponents, including this 45-0 win over Texas.
Day intercepted on the Texas 25 and scampered to the final score. Oklahoma 45, Texas nothing.
Barry Switzer has added 3 more championships on the OU scoreboard, including last year, 1985. And just what is Switzer's definition of tradition? That's easy.
Well, I think it's synonymous with Oklahoma football. I think tradition is established through years and years and even decades of winning, being one of the winningest teams in college football or any sport you're involved in.
Every coach has his own definition for tradition, but in every case, that definition involves winning.
Tradition, really, to me, as I perceive it, as the young people that are coming up perceive it, is what have you done of late? You know, everybody on our squad, with the exception of fifth-year seniors, have been to a bowl every year that they've been here. Again, I think our guys expect it.
But the Cowboys, the Sooners, and the Huskers aren't the only Big Eight teams that have enjoyed going bowling. How about this fact? In the last 8 years, every Big Eight team has been to at least one bowl game. So it's no surprise that tradition means so much to Big Eight coaches, both past and present.
Good! He got it!
I think tradition is essential to building a football program.
Year in, year out, why it's the toughest league in the country, I think, and it's very very aggressive and very very fine league, and I enjoy watching them.
Tradition, it means different things to different people, but on fall Saturdays throughout Oklahoma and the Midwest, tradition means just one thing: Big Eight football.
What about our predictions? The three of us agree it'll be Oklahoma, Nebraska, Oklahoma State, and Colorado. Robbie, comment.
I think Oklahoma's the best team in the league, and I'm impressed with Colorado. I think they're on the way to being a first-division ball club every year.
Bob Jr.?
I think Oklahoma has a chance to win every single game, including a bowl game. Nebraska, I don't know, because of the scandal. Oklahoma State and Colorado, the only reason OSU's third, because they have Colorado at home, I think.
And I think Missouri will upset somebody this year. How about that for a dark horse prediction? We'll be covering the Big Eight here on Channel 4. Join us. Thanks for being with us.